Well, in Texas turned out to be arguably the best race we've ever seen. Jan Beekes will be here to tell us about CART's plans to make the racing better this weekend at Belle Isle. Dr. Jerry Punch, Benson.
And this is RPM Tonight. The racing world is still buzzing about Sunday's Indy Racing Northern Lights Series event at the Texas Motor Speedway. In fact, Marlo Klein says it could be the kind of performance that pushes the league over the top.
If the 1979 Daytona 500 opened the public's eye to NASCAR, Sunday's race in Texas could do the same for the IRL. After 5 years of struggling with few fans in the stands, low TV ratings, and a lack of sponsorship on the cars, the June Texas 500 could be the IRL's defining race.
It was our best weekend that I can recall in the last 5 years, and you know, I've had a lot of people say it was the best open-wheel IndyCar race they've seen ever, but you know, it was one of the best, if not the best.
We've had a handful of races that have been that competitive, maybe not with, you know, that many cars, but there's been packs of three and four that have gone at it like that. But I think, you know, when you group them together 12 at a time, it pretty much puts a different complexion on the series.
I think now with this new formula, 3.5-liter formula, it allows us to go out there and be competitive as we are, because it's almost like restrictor plate racing, I guess. I've never driven those cars, but it seems like when I got in front there at the very beginning, it was like, okay, I thought I was going to take off, and then I wasn't going anywhere, and all of a sudden you're getting passed again. And I thought, this is not like I know it.
The defining moment for me was when Greg Ray was in 10th place, and he was 1 second off the lead. That tells you something. That tells you that there were nine cars going 210 plus miles per hour in front of Greg, and they were 3 by 3 by 2 by 2. It was pretty neat.
A record 31 lead changes among 8 drivers provided the script for the league's most exciting race. But every good play should have a big finale. The final laps between Scott Sharp and Robbie McGee produced the closest finish in the series history.
The mile and a half tracks have really provided a great showcase for this formula, and it's different than running here at the Speedway, and it's different than running at Phoenix or at Colorado.
Indianapolis was a heck of a race, and Texas was a really good race. Vegas was a good race. Phoenix was a good race. We've had nothing but good races, you know, and surely people will start recognizing that, and if they want true entertainment, start coming to our races. I mean, I just don't think there's any finer product going around a racetrack than there is in the IRL right now.
If the IRL is going to capitalize on this success, it must expand its schedule. This year, the series is only running 9 events. Next year, the goal is between 12 and 14 races. In Indianapolis, Marlo Klein, ESPN.
Sunday's winner, Scott Sharp, joins us now from Indianapolis. Scott, congratulations. All I can say is, what a race.
Thanks, Sean. I mean, I'll tell you, it was just awesome to be a part of it. It was a wild ride. I mean, I was white-knuckling that thing all the time. I mean, for that many laps, for us to be just, you know, an inch or two apart, so many cars in a group, you were just scared that, you know, as the tires got older, the cars tended to slide more. You were just worried that one guy might just slide up a little bit and we'd all be gone.
Now, what goes through your mind, say, when you're involved in a side-by-side duel down to the wire like you were with Robbie McGee, or do you just react and not even think about what you're doing?
Well, I mean, I guess some of it's instinctive, but really, I didn't have much of a choice. I was the leader. I put the pedal all the way down for the last 20 laps. I actually put my left foot on top of my right foot, and I wasn't going to lift. And I just tried to make Robbie go around the outside, make him have the long way, and you know, do whatever I could do to not make it too easy for him.
Now, on the last lap, you kind of made a little swerve up the track, I think, in 3 and 4 toward Robbie that seemed to kind of cause him to check up just enough to break his momentum. Was that a planned move, or did the car start to break loose on you?
No, it didn't break loose. I don't really know what happened there. You know, Robbie had a heck of a run. He was smart. He laid back, got a draft on me coming off 1 and 2 on the last lap. And, boy, I thought he had enough to slingshot by me. If he'd had about just a few more feet, he probably could have cleared me and tucked in front of me. But luckily, he drove me down in hard, and on the inside, I really made up some gain. And I was really tight on the bottom. He kept me tight. And I wanted to move him up a little bit just to make sure he took the long way around. But we raced each other real clean. It was great to see. Really, all day, everybody kept their heads about them and raced each other clean.
Yeah, they sure did. I mean, we talk about the last few laps or so, about how exciting they were. But the entire race, I mean, it was huge packs of cars running together side by side and no incidents. But I would imagine that from the driver's cockpit, that's got to kind of wear you out when you get toward the end of the race, doesn't it?
I tell you, by the time that race was over, I was mentally fried. I mean, physically, I'm fine, but mentally you're just so drained. You know, when it was just basically a 12-car pack, six deep, two wide, constantly. And, you know, just like I said earlier, you're constantly just having to hold your line. You're fighting your car a little bit. You're trying to get as much of a draft as you can, trying to keep your car in check. And you have a guy, you know, sometimes to your left, sometimes even to your right. Sometimes we're three wide. So you just really had to have your wits about you all day long.
Well, there probably aren't too many racing fans around the country now who don't know about this exciting finish and race. So in that respect, how important is it for the Indy Racing League?
I think it's huge. You know, I mean, a lot of people have been very impatient with the Indy Racing League. You know, they wanted it to be as big as some of the other large series right now. And I think the series is just starting to hit its own stride. You know, if you think about, we've got Northern Lights, we've certainly the ABC, ESPN contracts, both those are five-year deals. And I just think, you know, soon we're all anticipating a really terrific schedule for next year that'll be released shortly. We're getting great entries at each race, and obviously our on-track product's really fantastic. So I think it's not going to be long before the IRL's really shooting to new heights.
All right. Well, best of luck to you, Scott. Once again, congratulations, and have a good time this weekend out in Colorado.
Thanks, John. We're going to try to keep things going with the Delphi car, see if we can keep moving up in the points.
All right, we'll talk to you again real soon.
Thanks.
Later on RPM Tonight, we ride along with the consistent Bobby Labonte. And when we come back, Jan Beekes tells us to expect more passing this weekend in Detroit. Success on the road courses.
Well, I would say they certainly have a great shot, John. You know, but Toyota has already passed, I think, the toughest test of the season, and that's Long Beach. And that's because at Long Beach, you have the widest RPM range of any racetrack that you go to. 4,500 RPM in the hairpin, 16,000 RPM at the end of the front straightaway. So with that kind of rev range, we saw they did extremely well at Long Beach with Jimmy Vassar finishing third. Now at Long Beach, they used a 7-speed gearbox. When you do that, that does narrow the range somewhat. They'll try it again in Detroit, but I'd expect they'll do fine.
Now, the most common complaint about Detroit is that there's no passing on the track. Do you expect that to still be the case this year?
You never know, but there are some things that have changed that'll help the situation. First of all, in the past, we've had competition between tire makers when you go to Detroit, so therefore the tire manufacturers Goodyear and Firestone would bring the softest rubber they possibly could to give you grip, but during the course of the race, you have all those marbles along the racetrack. Now, because we only have Firestone this year, I check with them, what tire are you going to bring? They're going to bring the same tire they used at Long Beach, which, if you remember from that race, very few drivers had any complaints whatsoever about marbles. So Belle Isle is still very, very tough to pass, don't get me wrong, but at least now there shouldn't be marbles to get in their way.
On both days of last week's Mid-Ohio test, Penske was the quickest. Does that team look as if it's finally getting its program back on track?
Yeah, you know, I don't think they were that far off track. And the reason I say that is they have been quick pretty much every racetrack they have gone to this year, but they've had a couple of uncharacteristic miscues in the pits from a strategic standpoint. Like we talked about in Milwaukee, Gilles DeFerrin comes in and they mistimed a timed pit stop. And I would say with the Penske organization, that won't be around too much longer. I would say they're truly championship contenders.
I've seen some published reports that CART may be racing in both Germany and England next year. Do you think that's going to happen?
I think so. I've heard the same rumors and read the same reports, but I have been told that the franchise board has not yet voted on the issue, so we shouldn't really jump to conclusions too soon. But what that does, John, is that brings then the racing series up to 22 events. And the reason I say that is they've already added Monterrey, Mexico, and then you would have both Germany and England. And the only casualty that I've heard of would be St. Louis, the Gateway Circuit, because many people have talked about we're not going back to Detroit. That's incorrect. Detroit does have one more year on its contract.
Yeah, and I hate to see him lose St. Louis, my hometown. Tony George was quoted last week that he may expand the Indy schedule to 3 weeks next season. What kind of a monkey wrench is that going to put into the plans of some of the CART teams that hope to be at Indy next year?
Well, it could throw a huge wrench into the plans because I just said you've got 22 races. And we already know that CEO Andrew Craig has said, as we said a couple times here on the show, he wants to have the racing concluded by the start of the NFL football season. It makes sense for television ratings. So how do you take 22 races and then leave a three-week hole in the schedule around in May for the Indianapolis 500? They've got some tough decisions to make.
I don't know. Maybe they should talk to the NASCAR people. They know how to cram things in. Jan, stick around. We have an email coming up for you a little bit later on.
Okay, John.
Still to come on RPM Tonight, a breakthrough weekend for Robert Presley.
House Call is brought to you by Tylenol. Take comfort in our strength.
Our house call today comes to you from Jasper Racing, home of the Jasper Engines and Transmissions Ford Taurus, driven last Sunday to a fifth-place finish in the Kmart 400 by Robert Presley. And Robert, congratulations on what was an outstanding day all afternoon.
I tell you what, we was really happy. It's been the first race all year that everything went together just all day, no flaws.
I got to ask you, though, it's raining. We see the windshield wipers on the pace car going on lap 180, 181, 182. And people at home are saying, Robert Presley is going to win this race. What was going through your mind?
I tell you what, it was just, I was praying. I was praying that the rain was coming. Didn't know what we was going to do. I mean, I don't know why we was taking two tires on at the last minute. Ryan called in, you know, said two tires, two tires. Robin said it was raining up in the spotter stand. So, man, we was just praying that the rain was coming and we was going to take it any way we could get it.
I mean, people would say, okay, if the rain comes and they red flag the race right then, as opposed to 20 minutes later, you win it, and they say that's your first Winston Cup win. And people might say, well, you backed into it, but you guys were there all day long.
Yeah, I mean, we ran the top 10 all day. The car, I mean, just run flawless all day. It was great. You know, long in the run, we was as good as anybody. We were just a little bit slow on the starts there, but, man, you know, a fifth place at Michigan still is a big plus for this team.
They say teamwork and chemistry are so important, but Ryan Pemberton, you know, Doug Bauble, all the guys, this team has really come together in the past couple of months. He made an early call for two tires, which got you toward the top 10, and that was the big difference early on to keep you there.
Yeah, it cost us at California earlier with this same car. We taken on two tires and fell back, lost a lap, but we still top five car at California. This time we took two tires early. We knew the car was good. Ryan come on and said, everything goes our way. We've got a top five today. And sure enough, you know, all day long, the car was just great.
You walk in this shop, everybody's smiling. You hear them laughing and giggling. You come in also. I haven't seen you smile that much since your last double eagle, yeah, on the golf course. I mean, what does this kind of run do for this race team?
It's doing good. I mean, it's exactly what we needed. You know, we had a top five, but at Dover, we had a great race car at Dover, and a battery cable broke. So we've had everything we needed all year. This has been the first week that it's all come together. And now the momentum, I think everybody in this shop is ready to go to Pocono and just do the same thing again.
Dr. Jerry Punch joins us now in the studio. And Jerry, the thing about Robert on Sunday, not just the fact that he almost stole one, but he ran really well the entire race.
John, he really did. I mean, people may look at that race and say, well, Robert Prescott lucked into a top five finish. That's not the case at all. He qualified 31st, but look at the guy who won the race, Tony Stewart, qualified 27th. But Robert Presley, when the caution came out on lap 19, Robert had come all the way from 31st to 18th spot. He comes down pit road. Ryan Pemberton makes the call to change two tires and two tires only. He comes out of the pits in sixth position. Now, for the rest of the day, he ran no worse than 10th. In fact, ran in the top seven for most of the afternoon. So, John, he was a factor all day long.
Now, he said that a lot of his peers, other drivers, were kind of pulling for him. That's really not uncommon, I guess. If you can't win, you want to see the underdog win.
You know, and no one wants to pull for someone else, but if they can't win the race exactly, like you said, John, I mean, he told me that John Andretti came up and said, you know, I know you've been trying so long and so hard. So we were saying, you know, why couldn't the rain, if it had to come, why couldn't it have come 20 minutes earlier when you were leading the race and then a red flag didn't you win? He said Ward Burton came up to him, a lot of the drivers came up to him and said, you know, why couldn't the rains have come? He went to his buddy Rick Bass and said, now, Rick, let me just put it this way, Rick. If you were leading the race and I was a couple laps down and it was about to rain, and knew the rain was like 15 minutes away, I would have parked my car on the racetrack and refused to let him move it until the rains came. Now, why can't you think of things like that? Rick sort of laughed and went on, but Robert really wanted to win, and as well as they ran, they certainly had the red flag the race earlier, and he won it. No one could have said he didn't deserve it.
Now, talking about somebody who deserved a victory over the weekend, Eddie Cheever in that IROC event on Saturday, that was quite a performance.
It was. I mean, Eddie coming all the way from Texas after the problems with trying to qualify there with the rain in Texas, and then getting in the car, didn't have time to shave that morning, got in it, and when you beat Mark Martin and you beat Dale Earnhardt at Michigan, you've done something. But Eddie worked at it. I mean, don't let him tell you he didn't, because we'd go in the IROC trailers, he'd be sitting here looking at tape like a football coach, running a tape forward and backward, watching those passes at Daytona and Talladega, trying to learn from mistakes he had made about letting cars draft by on the inside or outside. And he drove a flawless race in Michigan, and really happy not only for Eddie Cheever, but for all the Indy Racing Northern Light Series drivers who had to say, yeah, our guy got one at Michigan.
That was a great race, too, and also a great race at Texas that we saw. Now, Shauna Robinson was injured in a crash during the ARCA race on Saturday. How's she doing?
I mean, she's obviously very, very sore, and when you hit like she hit, I mean, she hit a ton She broke some ribs and also broke her right shoulder blade, but she's going to get in the car and drive at Pocono, start the race at Pocono this weekend, and have Ed Berry replace her. But she's a tough lady. She's not only a very attractive and very sensitive and heartwarming young person, but she is a physically fit race car driver, because you get in a car with a broken scapula, I'm sure Bobby Labonte or Terry Labonte, a lot of guys will tell you that hurts. That's very painful. And she's going to get in a car this weekend and drive. So kudos to Shauna Robinson and her team.
I'd have trouble sitting in this chair with a broken scapula.
Me too, John.
Thank you very much. We'll talk to you next
Thank
week.
You.
Bobby Labonte heads to Pocono this weekend with a fairly comfortable 98-point lead over Dale Earnhardt in the chase for the NASCAR Winston Cup Championship.